Okay, good morning everyone and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee in 2017. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided to MSPs present in digital format, tablets might be used by members during the meeting. So when you see us on our phones or our tablets, we're not playing games, I promise you, we're looking at our committee papers, and that's what we're doing. No apologies have been received this morning, so we'll move immediately to agenda item one, which is declaration of interest. Now before we do this part formally, can I first of all put on record my thanks to Ruth Maguire, MSP, who is a departing member of this committee, and thank her on behalf of all the MSPs present for all her hard work on the committee up till this point. But I'm also pleased to welcome Jenny Gilruth, who's joining us, so welcome Jenny, and can invite Jenny to declare any relevant interests that you may have that may be relevant to the remit of this committee.
Thank you, convener. Good morning. It's good to be here. I suppose relevant to this committee, I am the Parliamentary Liaison Officer to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills.
Okay, thank you very much. Good to have you on board. And we now move to agenda item two, which is post legislative scrutiny of the High Hedges Scotland Act 2013. So today's evidence session will take place in a roundtable format to allow for a more free-flowing discussion of issues. And can I welcome everyone? I won't introduce you all. I'm going to allow you to introduce yourself as we go around the table. But before we do that, can I just say that the committee is very keen to find out how this particular piece of legislation has or hasn't worked. Has it got better as it's went along? What still needs to be addressed? I know many people here today have got their own stories to tell and their experience with local authorities, and we're keen to hear that. So there'll be a degree of formality because that has to come with these proceedings, but we're keen to get a conversation between the witnesses present. So that said, we'll do the introductions and we'll get going. So I'm Bob Doris, MSP for Glasgow, Maryhill and Springburn, and I'm the convener of the Local Government and Communities Committee.
My name is Pat McLaren. I'm here today representing Scothedge. Scothedge was the body instituted to lobby for change in the main to assist victims of unreasonable behaviour related to trees and hedges. I've been working with other members of Scothedge for 2 or 3 years. During that period, I spent a considerable time liaising with the Scottish Executive and the revision of the guidelines to support the Act. I'm delighted to be here and hope to give further input and evidence with respect to the Act.
And I'm Pamala McDougall, and along with my husband James, we're founding members of Scothedge in the year 2000. We'd like to pay tribute briefly to Hedgeline, which worked on behalf of the rest of the UK and supported us financially until we began campaigning wholly in Scotland to meet the specific needs in Scotland. So after 13 years of campaigning through changes in government, public petitions committee, banner waving, writing letters, listening to countless horror stories from hedge victims, and finally seeing the High Hedges Scotland Act 2013 come to fruition, thanks to Mark MacDonald's private members bill, I handed over the watching brief at that time to Pat and had a rest. But now here we are again, and during the previous time, our small campaigning group gained a lot of experiences and statistics. And we're proud to produce this booklet. Some of you might have seen it. It's called A Growing Problem.
And could you tell us more about that booklet perhaps later? Because we'll just do some introductions just now. But you're a superb campaigner because you've took your opportunity to say a little bit more about your organisation, and credit to you. But we'll continue with the introductions just now.
Thanks, convener. I'm Elaine Smith, MSP Labour for Central Scotland, and also the deputy convener of the committee.
I'm Roger Niven from Inverness. I've been living in our current property, myself and my wife, for about 17 years, and throughout that time we've had a problem with the high hedge of a neighbour, and have gone through the process without success.
I'm Catharine Niven, and for now, I'm happy to go with what Roger said. We live in the same house and have the same problem.
I'm Andy Whiteman, MSP, representing Lothian for the Scottish Green Party.
John Bolbot, I'm from Alva in Clackmannanshire. I have an ongoing high hedge problem we'll talk about later.
I'm Kenneth Gibson, I'm the SNP constituency MSP for Cunningham North, very much supportive of the legislation, very concerned that it is not being it is not delivered as well as I believe it should have or could have done, and therefore very keen to hear from people directly how we can improve this legislation to make it much more effective in the months and years ahead.
Hi, I'm Liz Grant. I was an unsuccessful applicant in East Renfrewshire. I have a apparently non-hedge, but there's no right of appeal and I can't go anywhere and do anything about it, so that's why I'm here.
I'm Donald Brown. I live in Kellis, near Dallas, in Murray, that is, and I have been through this process only to lose on appeal when my neighbour interfered with the evidence. But again, we can talk about that later.
I'm Alexander Stewart. I'm a Conservative member for Mid Scotland and Fife.
I'm Donald Shearer. I've lived in the same house for 35 years and had discussions with my neighbour throughout that time. I was present when the Act was passed, and I was delighted that at last it would give me an opportunity to reduce the height of the hedge. I have 28 trees along my boundary. Unfortunately, it was considered not to be a hedge.
Hello, I'm Jenny Gilruth, the MSP for Mid Fife and Glenrothes.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for those introductions. We'll move to our opening question from Kenneth Gibson, the MSP.
Yes, thank you very much. And first of all, I'd like to thank everyone for the very high quality of the submissions. And I realise there's a lot of emotion and passion involved in this particular issue, which blights the lives of, unfortunately, too many people, including a number of my own constituents. There's two things I'd like to throw open, convener. First of all, before the legislation it was introduced, one of the things that Scothedge emphasised was that when legislation came in England, the very fact that that legislation existed had a very significant impact in terms of the reduction in hedge disputes. It was argued up to 90% because a lot of people who are guilty of growing huge hedges to the detriment of their neighbours took cognizance of legislation, didn't want to end up with court action, and therefore acted as one would expect people to do responsibly. So I want to ask, firstly, if people can advise whether or not there has been that impact, regardless of the other concerns and issues that we'll no doubt delve into. And the second thing I would want to throw open is, in this first page of the Scothedge submission, it says it's still apparent that some local authorities are continuing to find ways of evading implementation fairly in the spirit and in the meaning of the Act itself. So I'd like to throw that open to our visitors today.
So the first part, I suppose, was has there been less disputes in this area due to the legislation?
It's effectively been resolved without having to take forward an application, as because the Act exists in itself, as was suggested prior to enactment, because that's the experience in England. And then just really a yes or no to that. I'm more concerned about the local authorities' alleged evading of the spirit and meaning of the Act.
Okay. I certainly think, Pat, it would be very helpful if you could answer the first part of Mr. Gibson's question first of all, and then give a flavour of where the spirit of the Act isn't been upheld. And I think there's a number of stories around the table that the people want to tell practicalities of that.
I think possibly that if you have a simple privet or Lalandi hedge, it is very obviously a hedge, then people are being advised by their councils that it's a high hedge and they're reducing it, sometimes never even going through the process of applying for a high hedge. It's the difficult scenarios that are not a simple hedge that we all, you know, you walk down the street, you see a Lalandi hedge, that's a hedge. But if you're living behind a row of trees which is deciduous and evergreen, that people think, well, that's not a hedge, especially our councils. That hasn't been addressed, and that's still a problem.
Okay.
In Midlothian, there have been three applications which have been adjudicated by the council. All of these were 2-3 years ago when the Act first came in. None of them were successful, so the people had paid their fee and got nothing for it. And I think other people considering making an application have looked at it and said, the council doesn't allow this, so we'll not bother.
The other side of that is that many people around this table who have non-hedges aren't even registered with the council. They're not noted, the council don't register them anywhere, and actually, as far as the councils are concerned, they don't exist because you don't have a hedge. Now, it's very obvious Glasgow Council do a pre-application check and they've said that these hedges aren't hedges. So we don't know, you know, it's obvious it's not addressing that type of problem.
Now, for anyone listening, could you explain what you mean by a pre-application check?
You can, it's quite interesting because some councils will come out to your house and look at it before you put an application in. Highland Council will charge for this, other councils don't. And if the council tell you that your hedge is not a hedge, don't bother applying, it's not registered anywhere. So we've no actual record of how many applications are in that category.
Okay. That's helpful. Emma, to add to this, did you want to come in, Pamela?
Well, just in response to the effect that the English legislation had, it certainly did have a deterrent effect. And we were hoping, in fact, when the Act came into being, that it would have the same kind of deterrent effect in Scotland. I know from anecdotal evidence that it did. But there are no records, as far as I know, that tell us how many. So it would be interesting to know, perhaps from another source, because we couldn't find out from the councils.
So the legislation has had some impact. We don't know the scale of it, but at the end of the day, what we're really then having to talk about from now on is the impact or lack of the impact of legislation on the more severe cases that are affecting everyone around this table.
Would it be helpful to move on, because I looked at a lot of the evidence and one of the issues with it is it seems fairly clear in the legislation how you would define a hedge, but apparently not so when it gets to local authority level. And I can see lots of reaction to that. Can we get some of that on the record, please? So who would like to go first?
No one has yet responded to my question, which is right in the front of the Scottish document about evading the Act, about the councils not following the spirit of the Act, you know, like, you know, the councils perhaps dotting a lot of I's and crossing a lot of T's rather than looking at it in a much more flexible way, which I think we were, when the legislation was passed, we were anticipating.
I wonder if Mr. Niven is about to put some of that on the record. Maybe local authorities are bending over backwards to define something as a non-hedge rather than using the powers they have, perhaps. Yeah, Mr. Niven.
Thanks, Convener. The property that we have the problem with was currently owned or changed hands a good few years ago before we moved into our property. And as we went through the process, we managed to find out who the previous owner of the property was, and we wrote to them and told them about our problem, asked them if they would comment on whether, in fact, they planted the Leylandia, which is mainly Leylandia that we have behind us, and whether they planted it as a hedge. And I have the letter here, which I'll read from. It says, with reference to your question relating to the trees on the boundary between our neighbour's house and ours, I have discussed the matter with my wife, and we can confirm that when we planted the Leylandia, they were planted as a hedge, as at the time there was absolutely no screening to that part of our boundary. If we had intended the trees to be anything other than a hedge, we would not have planted Leylandia, but some other species. We went through the application process, application was refused by the council because they said, you haven't got a hedge. And refunded our £450. However, we then went to a solicitor and he wrote to the council, and after many weeks, we got a response. And our solicitor had sent this letter from the previous owner of the neighbour's property to the council, and the council, in summary, quote a paragraph here. It says, your letter refers to the trees being a hedge because they were intended to be planted as such by the previous owner of the land on which the trees were planted. Name of the owner. While noting the terms of the letter, this does not alter the fact that the trees do not, in our opinion, meet the dictionary definition of hedge referred to in the guidance. And that, for us, sums up where this is going well wrong. If you have somebody who says, I planted a hedge, I wouldn't have planted this vegetation unless it was going to be a hedge, and the council can say it's not a hedge, I'm afraid the legislation isn't working for us.
Okay, thank you. Is that a similar experience that I always want to share? So, Liz Grant, did you want in first? I'll take Dr. Brown after that.
Well, when you're talking about local authorities kind of fudging the issue, my hedge, which I think you've got photographs of and which I've brought some more in, which I can pass around, which will give people an idea. It's large size. I don't know how good your eyes are. I'll pass that round. But basically, the local authority came out to my property. They didn't actually tell me they were coming out. I got a phone call from my daughter, who was 16 at the time, saying, "This guy's creeping around in the hedge. You know, I think you should come and see." So, of course, I shot home from work thinking, "Oh, gosh, you know, what's going on?" And it turned out to be the council officers, and they came into the house, they looked at it, they agreed it was a blight on the property. In the submission, they had a copy of our title plan, showing where the trees were planted, and they've said in their decision that it is assessed by the council as not being a hedge, but instead a tree belt, which forms one of the landscape's features of the golf course. The trees would appear not to have been planted as a boundary treatment between the golf course and the site boundary, and the planting is not in the form of a hedge. Now, this just flies in the face of everything you'll see in these photos. If you want to create a hedge, you plant a double row staggered plantation, and then you will get a thick, impenetrable hedge. The captain of the former captain of the golf club has recently planted a hedge at the end of the street with beech saplings, and it follows exactly the type of thing we have here. But I'm talking about Sitka spruce that are now 35 metres high. You know, they're massive. But I don't know if the council made a mistake in saying they're not on the boundary, because we have a private road in front of us, but we own the road. And we own a bunker, a sort of sit-out area on the opposite side of the road. But I mean, you wouldn't sit there because it's now just dark and flies and everything. But these houses were built on the golf course to take account of the views. I mean, my house used to be called Fairways. I mean, that's just a laugh now. So I don't feel it's worked for me.
Okay, thank you for putting that on the record. But you would contend that the legislation as drafted would appear to make it clear that it is a hedge. It's the interpretation of the legislation rather than the legislation itself.
I just couldn't understand it, because I'm a lawyer. And okay. I looked at it and I thought, well, there's no way this doesn't comply. You know, it's two or more trees. It's in a row. I've got two rows, in fact. It's on the boundary. I've printed off the boundary. I've had it scaled up. I've gone to a lot of expense getting someone who knows about light levels and things, which I have no knowledge of. And yet, it's not. It's a landscape feature. Now, if a council's allowed to call something like that just a landscape feature, well, anything could be, you know.
Okay, that's very helpful. We'll get to some more of those examples on the public record. Dr. Brown, I know you wanted to come in.
Yes, when I was thinking about putting an application in, Moray Council officials came out to look at my situation, and they were quite sympathetic. They didn't talk didn't quibble about the definition of a hedge, but he did say in passing that he was disappointed that other councils he knew of were finding ways of avoiding taking any action in these cases. Now, that's from a council official who obviously networks with other council officials and knows what's going on. So he was sceptical about their intentions and they're addressing the problems of the Act and taking it forward.
Okay, thank you. Now, I'll try and give preference to people who haven't the opportunity to speak yet. So Catharine Niven, bring in now.
Vina, one other point with relation to the Highland Council's interpretation of the definition. They say that it's the two or more trees or bushes forming a boundary. Our council points out that we have there's a scruffy fence along the boundary, the property boundary between our property and our neighbours, and that forms the boundary. So in practice, almost every urban hedge that you see is inside someone's garden, because that's the only place they can plant them. And the council, in our opinion, is using this as a reason or appears to be using this as a reason for taking no action, in that they don't, the trees are not actually on the boundary. There's a fence just a metre, less than a metre away from them. And so they say forming a boundary is part of the issue.
So is your perception that some local authorities are looking for an excuse not to apply the legislation?
I'm afraid it is, yes.
Okay, thank you. Pat McLaren, did you want to add in?
Yeah, I mean, the local authorities are circumventing this Act and they're bringing in their own criteria. The excuses they use for these trees not being hedges are they weren't planted at the same time. The original intentions were not that of planting a hedge. The trees are ornamental, part of a larger landscaping feature. The trees are a tree belt and a landscape feature of a golf course. The trees are not managed as a hedge, therefore they're not a hedge. The trees are individual specimens. That's another reason they used for not calling trees a hedge. And the spacing between the trunks is not what you'd expect of a hedge. And these are things, and they've brought in their own criteria. I mean, Aberdeen have brought in their own criteria for deciding, their criteria for deciding whether a hedge is a hedge, not referring back to the Act, which is what they should refer back to always, is back to the law, not the guidelines.
Okay.
And not their own guidelines.
Okay, that's helpful. Couple of MSP colleagues want again, but I'm going to give preference to Mr. Bolbot. I want you to come in next. Mr. Bolbot, I'll take you in next. I'm just making the point that I want to give preference to those giving evidence to MSPs. So I know you wanted to come in at that point.
Well, I was just going to add something. There were two things. First of all, most of the criteria for deciding whether a hedge is or is not a high hedge, they seem to be very, very subjective. I mean, what does it mean when you say something was planted is with an ornamental intention? I mean, you could do anything can be an ornamental intention. I could put a wheelbarrow in my garden and say it's an ornament. So, I mean, I don't think we're going to get anywhere until we work out a more scientific or objective way of assessing whether a high hedge is a high hedge or not. Some kind of, a photographic method of looking at the percentage of light blocked in any particular given area of hedge. So you could just slide an imaginary rectangle along the hedge and say, if you're blocking light by more than 20 or 30%, that part of the hedge is high and has to be thinned out. And then nobody can argue with it because you come up with a number and it's not down to a councillor's decision or an intention as to whether it was planted to be a hedge or not. So that's to do with the definition of a high hedge. Going back to the other thing about the reluctance of local authorities to implement the High Hedge Act effectively, which I believe they are not doing at all, is I think it probably comes down to, well, I suspect it comes down to council funding. It's because moving in and slicing down a high hedge in accordance with a High Hedge Act, which is allowed in the Act, by the way, I don't think that has ever been done in Scotland, correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think the law has ever been effective in that way. They've never, ever moved in and taken punitive measures. And any kind of legislation which is as toothless as that is never going to work. If I thought I could get away without paying a parking ticket merely by ignoring it, I might be tempted to do so, and so would everybody else, and our cities would be gridlocked. Now, I think the law has no teeth, and the reason is I don't think there's any sinister plot by the county councils. I think it's just that cutting down a high hedge is expensive. Yeah, 30-foot trees, employing contractors, it's difficult and it's dangerous work. It can be several thousand pounds. So that council, if it implements that, if it sends in contractors, they'll have a £5,000 hole in their budget and they're very nervous of then having to pursue the owner through the courts. The owner will say he's got no money and he's ill and obviously all the excuses that people will use to avoid paying fines.
Okay,
that's all I have to say.
Bring others in a second. That's quite helpful. Maybe at some point we have to explore the fees and fine structures within the Act to make it self-financing at a local authority level. so we can get the real kind of intention of local authorities in relation to this. Now, just to kind of move the debate along a bit, and we'll come back to a couple of MSPs that indicated they wanted to ask a few questions. I wanted to give them the opportunity. Andy, I might roll them together, actually. I'll take Andy Whiteman and then Alexander Stewart, and then I'll allow our witnesses back in for some more comments. And
Thank you, Convener. This has been extremely useful as an opening. I mean, it seems to me, reading the legislation does not define a hedge. It says that the Act applies in relation to a hedge, referred to in this Act as a high hedge, which, and then it goes on for those three qualifications. So first of all, it has to be a hedge. If it's not a hedge, you can't even get into A, B and C. So it seems to me that the problem here is that the definition of a hedge isn't in the Act. It has to be a hedge first, and then it has to be a hedge that meets these criteria. Whereas the term hedge is not defined, and it's attempted to be defined in guidance, which, as I understand from your evidence, changed from an Oxford Dictionary definition to another definition. So is that at the core of this problem, that if the Act actually defined a hedge, now it may not define a hedge in a way that you would like, but if it actually defined a hedge, there'd be less uncertainty as to what a hedge was and wasn't.
I should say any green vegetation, any vegetation which acts as a deterrent to your light is a hedge under the terms of the Act.
Now, can I just clarify then, because I think it was Scothedge that helpfully provided this extract. So it does say in that, and correct me if I'm wrong, that a hedge is, or that is, A, is formed wholly or mainly by a row of two or more trees or shrubs, B, rises to a height of more than 2 metres above ground level, and C, forms a barrier to light. That would appear, now whether that's legally watertight or not is another matter, but it would appear to the non-lawyers among us that that's a definition.
For a second.
Yes, of course.
I went to my library and I printed off the definition of hedge from the Oxford English Dictionary. It runs to 15 pages. The first item is the one which was originally quoted in the guidance, and is simply a row of bushes or low trees, hawthorn or privet. But it goes on to other meanings. The third meaning, which is far more generic and more appropriate in this case, I believe, says, it's said of a line or array of objects forming a barrier, boundary or partition. Now that basically can include any two trees, whether they're in a line or an array or a group. There is no need to change the definition in the Act. What needs to be done is make sure that the councils understand that the Oxford English Dictionary defines a hedge very, very widely. And I'll read that just once more. It's said of any line or array of objects forming a barrier, boundary, or partition. It is hugely wide. And that's the Oxford English Dictionary.
Would they be right in saying that we shouldn't be expecting local authorities to go to a dictionary definition to find a way of not applying the law? They should perhaps go to what's on the face of the bill and the guidance, and they should be reminded of that fact. Would that not be... I should really let Mr. Whiteman explore this further. My apologies, Mr. Whiteman.
Yeah, well, this is my observation, that reading the Act, it does not define a hedge. It says the Act applies in relation to a hedge, undefined, which... And then it goes on to say, these are the criteria that a hedge has to meet. But first of all, it has to be a hedge. And there's nothing in the legislation that says what a hedge is. And therefore, you go to a dictionary. Your dictionary is very wide, but that dictionary definition is not in the law. So that in itself is open to interpretation.
Or, indeed, indeed you could go to ministerial guidance on the matter.
Exactly. That which would,
instead. Yep. Mr. Brown, did you want in? Sorry, Dr. Brown.
Well, I was just going to say that I think we're perhaps even overcomplicating the issue. I think to interpret this and to interpret the Act, where it says the Act defines a high hedge as a hedge that is, you could just say a high hedge is, or a hedge, or anything formed, and just go on to the actual description of what the Act intended to cover. Because all the talk of hedge, I think, is what's actually confusing. You know, what Parliament, to me, intended was that the three things that it actually tries to define are the things that are covered. And that's it. I don't think, after the guidance was changed in any event, I don't think they really wanted to narrow it down too much further.
Okay. Dr. Brown will take you in next, and I haven't forgotten about you, Alexander Stewart.
Yeah.
Dr. Brown.
Just a brief comment. It seems to me that the Act was intended to alleviate people's living in the shadow, and surely that should be the focus of this, not the whatever's causing it. It could be a, you know, just because something is not planted as a hedge doesn't mean to say it doesn't let light through. You know, this is we're getting down the wrong track here. I think it should be, does it affect your amount of light reaching your property in either direction? One direction it's light hitting you, other direction it's the view, and focus on that rather than on, you know, what plants cause the problem. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'll tip Alexander Stewart and then allow our witnesses back in. Yeah.
Thank you, Convener. We've already touched on the difficulties of the definition, the guidance and the criteria. And I think that it's been very useful to hear that, because what the Act, as Andy Wickman has indicated, there was an assumption maybe made initially when the Act was drawn up. That assumption is now being played out across local authorities. You are all now potentially victims of that process. And I'd like to tease out a little bit the length of time it's taken in some of your cases to progress this, as to how the local authority tackles it. I think that you've made a very valid point about light and the whole aspect of how that can be interpreted or misinterpreted by a local authority to get out of the situation that you find yourselves in. And what I see from this is that there's more people getting out of the situation than actually having the Act developed and processed in a way that was trying to protect and ensure that the high hedge or the obstruction that they have is removed. And what I've heard from the majority convener is that it isn't working. These individuals find themselves in a situation that is appalling in some situations. We've seen some of the photographic evidence, and that then is being misinterpreted by local authorities, the length and breadth of Scotland. And something requires to be done to give them the opportunity as residents to tackle the situation. So, you know, but for me, I think the whole assessment process needs to be managed and needs to be assessed. If the assessment process was managed and assessed in a proper fashion, then it might alleviate some of the problems.
That's very helpful. I wonder if it's willful misinterpretation by local authorities, though, might be the thing. Before I take you in, Mr. Gibson, Pamela McDougall wanted to come in.
I can say something very briefly on a personal level about time. When we put in our request for a high hedge notice, we didn't hear anything apart from the fact that it had been just acknowledged. 2 months later, we phoned the council to say, how is it progressing? He said, we're working on it, but we're very busy in this department, which was a bit condescending, really, because it was big in our lives at the time. however, they sent out an official eventually. But my point is that the first time they sent out the official, it was an obvious, we're actually surrounded on three sides by these Lelandi. And the man hummed and hawed and said, yes, you know, it looks like, and non-committal, and went away, and we didn't hear anything then for another 2 months. And then we went back to the council, asked, what's happening now after 4 months? And the next day, the man, our neighbour, had every alternate tree cut down, cut right down. So we're left now with a long, long row of Lelandii all cut down. I think there's photographs to demonstrate that. So we're now left with these horrible, just as high Lelandii as ever before. And the branches are now going back. But the timing was 5.5 months from our application to a high hedge notice to the decision. And in that time, half the trees were removed. And when he came back, out of the blue, the man came back and said, well, it's not a hedge anymore. And that was a blow. That was a serious blow.
That's helpful. We got that. I'd like some more of that evidence to get put on the record here this morning. But just Mr. Stewart's point about the time in the process as well. Would anyone else like to put on the record anything about the time it took?
I'd just like to add that in the guidelines it says that the process should be carried out in a timely manner. Now, what is a timely manner? Okay. I think that should be specified. That should be whatever, 3 months' time you'll get the decision or whatever, but it would have been really good to have known.
Yeah, but I promise you, Mr. Gibson, I'm taking in, but
what I was going to say was a follow-up actually to exactly what Pamela said, the timely manner issue, because you mentioned time. And the other thing about local authorities willfully, in some ways, helping to flaunt the law by this chopping down of every second tree. I mean, clearly that's utterly against the spirit of the law. And for local authorities, you know, to accept that as a reason not to ensure that the entire row of trees is cut down to 2 metres, I think is completely unacceptable. And I think that just shows that they're not, the councillors are not following the spirit of the law when they allow that to happen.
And just before, believe it or not, there's a structure to all of this. Just before we go and expand on that further, Mr. Gibson, timely process, can we just exhaust that first of all? Does anyone else wish to put on the record about the length of time, even though you got an outcome that you didn't like? And no matter what legislation we have, people will always sometimes get outcomes they don't like. But we think there's a systemic issue with this legislation. But in the time the process takes, did anyone else have significant delays in relation to that process? Just before we go and explore that next matter further.
If I could just say that although mine was deemed to be a non-hedge, the local authority did copy out our submission to all the neighbours in the street and give them 28 days to respond about the hedge, and then came back and said it wasn't a hedge. So again, that's a kind of delaying tactic, I suppose, and obviously a waste, I would think, of public funds. If it's not a hedge, why bother?
Okay, well, Mr. Stewart, I tried. There's no great stampede about delays in the process. We've got one example there. Pat, do you want to add anything?
Sorry, I think the delay in the process, sometimes it's due to the volume of letters that need to go between the various different parties, and that does take a bit of time. There's an example of Gilruth Road that actually was on the books for over a year before it was sorted out, and the outcome in the end was very, very good and very positive. The trees had to be removed. I think in the start of the process, Pam, you suffered because the councils didn't know how to behave or how to deal with things. And the removing of 50% of your trees was absolutely disgraceful without taking the height down. And there is a case where the DPA reporter used photographic evidence and used that to then say, but this is how I want to deal with your trees now. And I think if that had happened in these cases, in Donald Brown's and in Pam's and the Parry's, if they had used the photographic evidence and said, your trees need to come down in height as well, if the councils had teeth and were prepared to do it, you would never get cases like John Bolbot's. And very quickly, your 50-odd cases, people would stop behaving badly like that, as would the councils.
So are there other examples of that? Like, I'm thinking about at the point where the complaint is made, there's clearly a breach of the legislation. Should the remedy be dictated by the local authority rather than another resident, again, trying to circumvent the legislation by pruning 50% or whatever it is of the hedge or alleged non-hedge? Perhaps there has to be more power that at the point where the offence is deemed to be evident, that the local authority should have the power to dictate what the local remedy is, rather than the what we heard in Pamela McDougall's experience.
If you photographic evidence as to how the hedge was prior to putting your application in, then the evidence is there that this is your neighbour is trying to circumvent the whole act by removing things.
But that may be the evidence, but it's whether the legislation gives the local authorities the power to dictate the remedy, which I think is what we're trying to explore. Yeah. Dr. Brown, you wanted to come in on this area.
I was successful initially. My council, there was no problem with the council, I say. I don't often praise our council, but this is one case. They placed an order on the trees. My neighbour appealed, and between the order being placed and the visit of the reporter, he did this, he cut out half the trees. Now, I'm sure there's some in legal circles, there's some buzz going around that this is a way to circumvent the Act because it's, you know, it's too common, this. The reporter arrived and really, I wouldn't say she took one look at the trees, but she looked at the trees, oh, well, these are not a hedge now. So I lost
The appeal of the trees is still as high, still as dangerous in a high wind. Because over 20 of them blew down at one point, but that's another issue. And I think, you know, it's not just councils that are failing. If the reporter comes out and sees somebody's tampered with the evidence, if I did that in a fraud case, I would be up in court. If somebody does it, and I've wasted money, I've lost all this money having applied for this, and I'm sure that other people will be in the same situation. If a reporter says that's okay, that's legal for you to fiddle with the evidence, and then goes away and I'm left in limbo, then I think, you know, it's not just councils that are failing the, you know, people who are taking out, you know, actions under this Act. I think it really needs to be sorted out at that end as well.
I suppose if a homeowner built an extension without planning permission, the council wouldn't say remove half of the extension, would they?
No, that's right, the entire extension.
I suppose. Yes. Any more examples of this happening, Donald Shearer?
On all these points, I mean, taking every other tree out doesn't take it away from the definition in the Act. Mm-hmm. So that I would say these are still high hedges and the council should still act on them.
And they're going to grow together. Because that's what they're doing now. The lower branches are now growing across. Am I going to have to take another action in 5-10 years if I'm still here to address the problem again and spend more money on it?
Okay. Points well made by our witnesses. Elaine Smith, do you want to add?
Thanks, convener. Can I just say, I think it obviously is timely, given what we've heard and the evidence we've had, that the committee has taken a look at this post-legislatively. What I suppose gets me, I think there could be some confusion maybe at times with particular trees and tree protection orders, but I was particularly struck by Mr and Mrs Niven's situation, because when my colleague Scott Barry first pursued this way back in 1999, I think the big issue then that was used as an example was Leylandi hedges. And quite clearly in this case, given there's a letter saying it was planted as a hedge, it is specifically Leylandi, I think, by looking at it. I can't for the life of me see why this particular case isn't deemed a hedge under the Act, because I think this was the very essence of what the Act was about and how clear-cut it could be. So I just wanted to put that on the record. I mean, obviously, I've not seen the property, I've not been there, but just looking from the evidence and the pictures and from what Mr. Miss Niven have been saying, that's what it strikes me. It strikes me that this is a very good example of what it was meant to be about in the first place, without any confusion around tree protection orders or how many trees are making up a hedge or what exactly a hedge is. That seemed to me to be the example of where it all started.
Okay. Are there other examples, I know there are because I've read it in the evidence, but rather you said rather than the MSP said, are there other ways that you think the Act is deficient that you'd like to put on the record here today?
I would just like to put on the record that it really doesn't have to be a formal hedge. It doesn't have to be in a specific row. My boundary with my neighbours, there are two of them, is 70 metres long. There are 28 trees along that boundary. They definitely weren't planted as a hedge, but they definitely do all shade my garden. They're all within 5 metres of the boundary. There are all kinds of trees. There's chestnuts, copper beech, 2 giant sequoia. There was 3, but he's taken one of those out. They are going to be enormous. They've been planted for 30 years. They grow 2 feet every year, and they'll continue to grow 2 feet every year for another 150 years. But the fact is that if trees planted in any pattern are preventing reasonable enjoyment of a neighbour's garden and house, surely they shouldn't be allowed to continue like that.
Okay, thank you. John Bolbot, did you want to add?
Yeah, my personal situation is much simpler than most of these. But I think it really cuts to the, in my opinion, it cuts to the heart of the problem, which, as I said before, is that local authorities are reluctant to, and even perhaps try to avoid action, because they fear it'll blow a hole in their budget, which they may not be able to recoup. Personally, I think that's the root of the problem. Now, my submission here sums it up. The High Hedges Act isn't working because it has no teeth. that basically I was successful in getting a high hedge notice issued against my neighbour. That was issued some time ago. It carried an 8-month compliance period. The 8-month compliance period finished 6 weeks ago. And the hedge has still not been cut, so therefore it's 6 weeks illegal. I've been in contact, of course, with Clapmanshire Council, and they just seem to be vacillating, pussyfooting around, writing to him asking for a schedule, asking him when he's prepared to comply. So, I mean, the tail is wagging the dog now. What is the point of a compliance period if it only signals the beginning of persuasion?
I wouldn't know. Politicians should never really ask questions they don't know the answer to. But I want to ask this one: would the council have the power, if it so chose to say you've not complied with the order? We're giving you another 4 weeks, but you now have a £500 fine levied against you, for example.
Well, something like that.
And indeed, does that power exist? I suppose is what I'm saying.
It says in the Act that they are empowered to. The High Hedges Act provides for a council to send workmen to a non-compliant property to cut a hedge, subsequently recovering costs from him. Clackmanager Council, I think, just are too frightened to do that.
Okay. So there's the power to recoup the costs,
in theory, but
not to issue... But not to have a shot across the bows of saying, here's a modest fine.
And as I said before, I think no... This is a huge weakness of the Act as it stands. I don't think, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think any local authority has done that. They haven't actually sent in the contractors to cut the hedge and recover the costs. And until they do that and show non-compliers that this is what will happen, you cannot refuse the law, it is against the law, then I think people will, as I said, will just ignore it. Interestingly enough, just as a finale, Clackmanshire Council have just sent me my council tax bill and a nice little pamphlet here telling me all the wonderful things that the council tax does for me. I just noticed that there's a section right at the end. It said, what happens if I don't pay on time? And then it goes through the help that they can give people who have financial problems. The bottom line, and it is the bottom line, the very last sentence, is if you fail to make payments, this could see your earnings being arrested, bank account being arrested, and your debt increasing due to legal fees. So they're prepared to put the boot in. If I was to say I'm not paying my council tax, I choose not to. They make it quite clear that I won't get away with that. So why can't they use that kind of muscle on a high hedge offender? They don't seem to want to.
And we're certainly intending asking them that question, and we will certainly put that to them. Now, because you were mentioning monies, I know we want to talk about the fees that underpin this process. Now might be a timely opportunity to go into that. Pat, Farn, do you want to?
Before we miss out the appeals section, I don't want, at the moment, all of us who have a non-hedge have no right of appeal. And that means that if your council choose not to allow your hedge to be a hedge, you have no right of appeal to anybody. Okay. And, they dismiss your case and you have no right to appeal to the DPA. So you can't take that outside your local authority. You can't take it outside local personalities. You've got nowhere to go. Even though your hedge is totally, and they accept that it's totally under the terms of the Act, it's a high hedge. But in their view, it's not a hedge.
Again, I'm asking that question. Do local authorities, whilst there's no appeals process, do local authorities have the permissive power to have a reconsideration, which is different from an appeals process? Because sometimes an appeals process, they look at the process rather than the judgment itself, whereas a reconsideration would be an overview of the evidence that's there to see if they've erred at some point within that.
If they're blocking your application in the first place, why are they then going to say that we're wrong?
I'm asking you a question that I should be asking the local authorities, of course. It's whether they have the power to review decisions made irrespective of whether there's an appeals process. But you put on record an important point. There isn't an appeals process. Is that a general concern that all of our witnesses have
Absolutely.
In relation to that?
Yes.
Catharine Niven.
The letter from our local authority said that the only recompense to us was judicial review, which we understand is enormously expensive, totally unfeasible for us.
Okay.
About fees, if I can speak about fees.
Yeah. I'm just checking, because I tried to move on to fees and I missed out the appeals process. Would anyone else would anyone else like to comment on the appeals process before we move on to fees? Liz Grant.
I would just like to say that the reason that you perhaps aren't getting a great deal of feedback generally on this is the fact that it's all silent. As we've said before, we don't have a record of how many applications have been dismissed by local authorities as non-hedges. I, because it didn't cost me anything to do it, submitted an appeal to the DPEA against the refusal not to deem the hedge a high hedge. We're getting into real semantics here. Because that was one way of actually publicising it and getting this no remit decision. And if you look on the DPEA website, there are countless no remits. And these are people who are in my position and similar positions where there's nothing else you can do. I mean, the local authority in my case had said to the golf club that the application has been returned to the applicant and the council has no intent of investigating this matter further. Then it goes on to say, you are perhaps aware that there were discussions on the site visit. I understand that by chance a member of your committee was present. My recollection from that discussion was that there was some understanding on the part of the golf club of the applicant's circumstance and the options still removed to explore some tree removal. And they've recommended a reopening of correspondence to explore works which would perhaps in part address her concerns. Well, that email is dated the 18th of February 2015. I've heard nothing.
Okay. Thank you. And now we'll move on to fees.
Yes, I've taken a great interest in this right from the beginning. And I've actually got a whole list of every council that charges a fee for every council charges a fee. The highest one is Glasgow at £500, and the lowest is Inverclyde at £182, which is quite a disparity. I know from my Scothedge work that people phone me up and say, I want to apply for a high hedge. I can't afford it. There's no way I can afford £450. There's no sliding scale. There's no concessions apart from one, which is, and I'll name it, South Ayrshire. And they do have a good sliding scale. People on various benefits, which are all means tested, of course. So I'm saying that the fees are too expensive. The councils are using this to prohibit applications as well. And I argue that there should be a sliding scale. And in any case, why should we have to pay for justice? Why are we having to pay out all this money, which we all of us have done, with no guarantee of success? And at the end of the day, I'm left with these Leilandii growing still, growing closer together at the top, and having to think about, do I want to try another high hedge notice application? But my heart, frankly, goes out to the people who phone me through Scothedge, weeping sometimes on the telephone and saying, how can you help me? Well, I can't pay all the fees, obviously. And even CAB are reluctant to become involved, although they try their best. But I think everyone here from the witnesses would agree that the fees are too high and should have a sliding scale, and we should be refunded the fees if successful.
Thank you for that. Let's see what everyone else thinks. Who'd like to make a comment on the system of fees? I will take in a second, okay. Pat, I promise.
Yep.
No one else wants to say anything now. Would anyone else like to comment on that, Dr. Brown?
Me again. Yes, I made comment in my submission to the committee here that if somebody transgresses by cutting down every second tree, I should get all my money back. I think this is ridiculous. I mean, this is robbery in two ways. Not only do I not get my daylight, but I also lose everything I have paid out on this attempt to get the trees reduced in height. And I think some kind of punishment for the landowners, subverting the intentions of the Act should be enforced.
Okay, thank you. Donald Shearer, then I'll take Pat McLaren after
if,
that.
If I could just say that in my application to Midlothian, they were quite quick on it. They took my £300, looked at the trees and said it's not a hedge, and when I complained, they did give me £90 back. So they took £210 for that quick look. But the thing that I think should happen is that if you are successful in the case, then the hedge owner should pay it, because that will be an incentive for him never to enter the argument in the first place. He will just know that he's got a downside if he loses. At the moment, he doesn't.
Thank you very much for that, Pat McLaren.
That was my point. I mean, even the local authorities, in their summary of their submissions, they felt that the tree owner should pay the fees should the High Hedge notice application be successful. There was quite a strong view on both the submissions and the local authorities that that should be the case.
Okay, thank you. Jenny Gilruth, did you want to come in?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. We've heard today about the kind of varying approaches to how the law has been interpreted nationally, in terms of the time taken, in terms of the appeals process, the fact that, you know, there isn't a central log of, you know, how many appeals have been rejected, haven't been rejected, or they just don't record it, the varying fees. I wonder, going back to your point, Pamela, you spoke about the local authorities and this idea of justice. And I just suppose, is there a cultural issue with our local authorities in terms of how the law is being implemented? Is there a reluctance for them to come out and engage with people in terms of how they deal with high hedges? Do you think they don't see it as an issue? Do you think they consider that actually their job is, you know, to run our schools, for example, they're not that particularly interested in it? Do they just kind of bat these problems away in your experience? And do you think we need to kind of, I suppose, go back to the letter of the law and look again at how it's being implemented in terms of how the local authorities view their responsibilities? Because it just feels to me that, you know, hearing from your experiences, they're going to the nth degree to try and avoid enforcement. And is that a cultural issue, do you think, at local authority level?
Well, you say engage with us, but they don't, actually. I wish they would. And, you know, they will not engage with us about in the process. We just get letters. We all get letters. Cultural, I'm not quite sure, because the people who have taken on the duty from the local councils are the planning departments. Now, the planners know nothing about, on the whole, high hedges and trees and what have you. And maybe they've found out since a little bit, but they're not experts. You know, they really, I'm sure, try to do their best, but they have a workload and they don't want to take on an extra workload. And we've thought about the financial constraints with the councils as well. Although we have sympathy with them to a certain degree, we have to live our lives too, and that's why we are paying our taxes. And to ask for £400-odd for just to come and see, you know, the trees that they hum and haw about. I'm sorry. My view of local councils, or my Angus local council, I'm afraid, is rock bottom just with this issue, because they give me no confidence whatsoever.
Pat McLaren, and then I'll take in after that. Jointy Pat first, OK?
The applications go into the planning department, I think, because they understand how tall a building is, what the light loss would be in a planning scenario, and they are supposed to understand that, you know, if you have two buildings close together, you will lose the light. And the tree officers quite often are attached to that department, but tree officers generally are the type of people that want to plant lots and lots of trees to make things look beautiful. So perhaps it's the wrong people who are looking to accept the high hedge applications. Mm-hmm. You know, we have the English version of the high hedge height and light loss document. There is one for England, and that is forever green trees. And we refer to it in our guidelines and in the Act that we should refer to that. But we actually need a Scottish version of that, because we take in deciduous trees, which are slightly different to the Lalandi trees and the evergreen trees. But we are to a much more northerly latitude. Therefore, we have shorter days than England has. We are also slightly different tilted as far as the you know, the length of days, the way that the sun interacts with our gardens. Therefore, I think if we had our own version of that document that is the go-to document, it would be easier for the local authorities and for the tree officers to say, well, you know, you've lost a certain percentage of the garden, of your you know, sunlight and daylight. Therefore, you know, it's there. And I think, John, you referred to that earlier. You know, you need a go-to document that states that's where you lost your light.
And that's a very good link. Is John Bolbot's next to make a comment?
I was just going to say that in my opinion, I do not think it's a cultural issue. I think because my personal experience with Clackmannanshire Council, it's the only experience I've had, they didn't have any problem issuing me a high hedge notice. That they have a problem in enforcing it. Yeah, and they seem to have sort of panicked now that the guy has just dug his heels in and he hasn't done anything. And they don't really know what to do. And that, I suspect it's not because they don't realise they could. Again, going back to what I said before, I think they're frightened of spending the money. It's a lot of money to spend. And I think he probably will refuse to pay them. And they may not want to get into all that legal shenanigans and end up out of pocket, perhaps.
Convener, that was my question. Do you think there's a reticence there because they're concerned that they could be taken to court on the back of it, and you know there's a fear there, and that's perhaps part of it? Or do you think they're looking for clearer guidance from the government on enforcement?
Well, as Clackmannanshire, I've been after them, contacting them recently, because the hedge is now, as I said before, 6 weeks illegal. And the officer in charge of the case has said that he is contacting the Scottish Planning Enforcement Forum, whoever they are, to obtain information from other Scottish local authorities on their experience in dealing with non-compliance. And they've also written to the guy, the hedge owner, as I said before, asking him for his schedule and his proposed plans to comply with the law. I don't think he's replied to them. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now, Lord Shearer, you wanted to come in?
I just wanted to come in on the English guidance on the acceptable light and just say that I worked down in England in Milton Keynes, and when I used to go out for a pub lunch, I used to sit in the shade of the hedge because it was always warm. When I go out to a pub in Scotland and it's sunny, I invariably choose a seat that's in the sun. So using the English guidance needs some adjustment.
Okay. I'll just leave that one hanging in there for a moment, perhaps. Pat McLaren, can you help me out with that?
I just wanted to say one more thing about John's point of... And Jenny, you asked the question. If we had a few cases like that where the authorities went in, took the trees down to the height they should be, charged the tree owner for the cost of it, if you had half a dozen of these cases, the tree owners would very quickly realise that actually we can't get away with this. Mm-hmm. And they would come to heel very quickly. And the discussion that we're having around here would disappear. We wouldn't be having it.
I'm just thinking about local authorities and like John Bolbot's been talking about, is there a disincentive because of the cost of seeking to enforce and manage this process? But if you look at local authorities and the monies they now make from various other forms of enforcement, I'm just wondering, it's not a reason to do it, of course, is there actually a valid business model around making this self-financing, and are they missing a trick there? Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering, any thoughts in relation to that? I know I've spoken about the fees before, but are local authorities perhaps missing a trick in terms of how they deal with this? Any suggestions? We've got local authorities coming the 10th of May, I should point out. I'm sure you'll be following that with interest. What suggestions would you like us to make to keep it civil, please? What suggestions would you like us to make to local authorities when they come in to answer questions from MSPs on the 10th of May? Mr. Bolbot.
Well, the only advice I could give them is that they should someone over there said, Pamala, I think, or was it Pat, said that ultimately if a precedent is set that the law is never enforced, and as I said twice before, I don't think it ever has been in that sense enforced. No local authority has cut trees and then taken the owner to court. So, I mean, if a precedent is set throughout Scotland that just ignore the High Hedges Act and they won't do anything, they won't take you to court, you won't have to pay the fine, just ignore them and they'll go away, then the law will be rubbish and useless. No, as I say, toothless. Just the same as if parking fines were never enforced, no one would ever pay them again.
That's perhaps one of the areas where local authorities make quite a significant amount of cash from time to time. Perhaps the parking attendant should be trained on how to spot a high hedge. That's not a serious suggestion, I should point out. Now, we are coming towards the end of this evidence session, so that I kind of throw open to all of our witnesses. It's an opportunity for, doesn't have to fit in with the line of questioning so far, but just some comments that you'd like to make, because that'll inform our line of questioning when we do speak to local authorities in a few weeks' time. I'll take Roger Niven first, and then I'll take you in, Pamala.
Just going back to the evidence I gave to start with, I think if an applicant can prove that a hedge was planted as a hedge, there should be no further test required. I take everybody's points about the light, and I think that's a big one. But also just an observation that local authorities seem to be able to interpret this act in so many different ways that the whole thing needs tightened up. You know, around the process.
Across the country in relation to it?
Absolutely. Yeah. And is it in fact, is this a job for the local authorities? I mean, Pat's talking about the planning officers. Are they the people to do it? That's a radical departure. Okay. But
Catharine, I think you're going to add to that.
I'm just thinking one of the things, postcode lottery is generally considered to be a bad thing, but here we are suffering from a postcode lottery. It appears.
Okay. Pamela McDougall?
I wouldn't like us to finish this meeting without acknowledging the mental health problems that it has caused, the depression and anxiety within families and within communities. I've spoken before about Scothedge members writing to me and phoning and emailing with huge problems. And they're afraid of their neighbours. They sometimes would not allow their names to be on a list, and they wouldn't join. Some of them wouldn't even join Scothedge because they're afraid of their names being on our list. But the anxiety and depression and the mental health problems I really would like to highlight, because I came across it so often.
And that's helpful, because committees can get very understandably process-driven in relation to this and look at the black and white of the legislation rather than the wider human impact. So thank you for putting that on the record. Mr. Gibson, yes?
Yeah, just to follow that, I think that is a real important issue, because I think a lot of the people who are involved in this situation feel that their opinions and interests just simply don't matter and they're not being recognised by local authorities. And these people are law-abiding citizens who kept their nose clean all their life and paid taxes, and then when they need the local authority, who they may never have been in contact with in 10, 20, 30 years, whenever, they're let down. And I think when someone seems to be acting against your interest, but there's not an equivalence in terms of how it's been dealt with, i.e. it's almost like, you're guilty until proven innocent rather than the other way around. So in other words, all the kind of weight of legislation appears to be, or certainly interpretation of the legislation appears to be, with the individual who's causing this problem. And I think that's obviously can only cause upset. And I know in my own constituency, none of whom are represented here, that's a real major concern for them. They just don't understand why this is actually happening to them. You know, people who've come from Glasgow, retired, saved up all their lives, bought themselves a nice house with a view, and then a couple of years later, a big, huge, hedges erupted in front of them, and they just think, why has this happened to me? What have I done wrong? So I really do think it's something we really need to take serious and get a grip on. That's why I'm delighted that the committee is bringing forward the period in which we have to review this legislation and not wait until 2019.
Yeah, and that was the decision we made as a committee. We wanted to do it at an earlier opportunity. I'm going to take in a second Donald Shearer. I'm taking you in next, but just to make the point, I am very close to ending this evidence session. So if there's something you haven't said yet, now's your time to oh, hands go up. Now's your time to do it. Donald Shearer.
I'd just like to say that when the councils are evaluating the effect or the reasoning for the application, the prime thing they should be looking at is how much shade is on the applicant's garden. Whether the hedge was planted in a straight line, whether it's trees that have been put in to form a screen but are in a copse, if you like, or whatever. If you have a big piece of ground and you want it to be screened, and you know that if you put it just in a hedge, it'll be reduced, but if you plant them in different places, still to create a screen, you'll be okay. That's what you'll do.
Okay, thank you very much. Dr. Brown?
I'd just like the, when you're considering this, to look at the a route for those of us who feel that we've been badly dealt with in terms of taking out alternate trees or be lost on appeal. I shouldn't have to go back and pay the whole fees again merely to write something that really shouldn't have happened in the first place, to correct a misjudgment, I think. And I'm sure that other people in similar situations shouldn't have to pay another £450, £500 to start the whole process again and the stress that causes. There should be some route for us to have an appeal or have a judgment overturned. I know it's difficult, but I really think for justice's sake, we need that.
Thank you very much. Pat McLaren?
I just wanted to say finally that I feel the guidelines are giving our local authorities too much individual scope for localisms. I've given 9 points as to where there's sections in the guidelines that we allow the local authorities to make up their own minds how they deal with this.
Okay, that's not the last word. Roger Niven, if anyone wants to speak, indicate just now and we'll come to the end of the evidence session. So Roger Niven.
Thanks, Convener. Just very briefly, yes, in addition to the frustration and the emotional cost of the situation, that we have an ongoing annual financial cost because we're spending around £400 a year taking moss off the roof, which is as a direct result of the trees. I'm sure we're not alone in that one.
Okay, thank you. Liz Grant.
I would also say that although we're all sitting here and we're considering the ins and outs of it, those of us that actually have to live with it, we look out every window or isolated windows or whatever it may be, and we see it every single day. And trying to keep your mind off it or look the other way or install blinds or whatever you have to do, it's very wearing. And I think sometimes if people could approach it more in a spirit of how would I feel if I had to put up with that, it might help.
Okay, thank you. That's perhaps a good note to end the evidence session on. Can I thank all our witnesses for taking part in what I think is a very useful discussion in terms of the scrutiny that our committee is going to do. As I mentioned earlier on, we are taking further evidence on the 10th of May from local authorities, so we'll put some of the questions and points you've raised directly to local authorities on the 10th of May, and we'll keep you updated in the progress of our post-legislative scrutiny. So can I thank you all for coming along, and can we suspend the meeting briefly to allow the room to be clear?